Thank you. It gives me great pleasure to introduce the honored guest this afternoon, my good friend Nick Hopkins. Although I'm a little bit puzzled and intrigued that Drs. Risai and Hopkins would choose me for this particular introduction, since Nick has embarrassed me at national meetings with this picture on several occasions. And I remind him that dinosaurs have ruled the world for 30 million years. however, I've known Nick and the family for a long time, and I think these words really come to mind: loyal, athletic, intelligent, kind, generous, attractive. But naturally, they apply to Bonnie. And his fondest wish when he goes to bed at night, and I believe this is also Bonnie's wish, is that he would wake up like this in the morning. My apologies to the rest of the family. but as anybody who knows me, I never make fun of anybody that I don't really care for, and Nick is very close. It is obligatory to touch on a CV of an honored guest, and you can read it for yourself here. In fact, it's an incredibly long CV, 178 pages. He's had so many accomplishments. He's been of service to organized neurosurgery, as you can read here. And here are a few of his professional highlights. I've just got to think that the family must get very tired of coming to all these lifetime achievement awards that he gets, but then there are no higher honors than the one he is receiving today. He was professor and chairman of the Department of Neurosurgery in Buffalo from 1989 to 2013. He was the pioneer in endovascular surgery as a neurosurgeon. And his department ranked 7th among most published neurosurgical departments in North America. He created the number one endovascular training center and taught a new generation of endovascular neurosurgeons this art. And he mentored the new chairman, Elad, who is sitting up here, who is now the current chairman. He's a surgeon, he's an entrepreneur, a leader, innovator, and friend. But what he is really most proud of is his incredible family. And here along comes the next generation, off to the right on the bottom. He's been an athlete all his life. This picture with Bonnie in the middle, this must have been taken in grade school. He was a great father. His three beautiful children, Margie, Bobby, and Betsy, are pictured on the right. They actually introduced us to Jackson Hole that we fell in love with. And on the bottom left, they are up on the Grand Teton as a family. The ultimate blessing is really the 8 grandchildren that they treasure. From a professional perspective, we've had a travel club of which he was an original member, and this required some very heavy social activities which he inspired. Later in life, he became a wine connoisseur. Now, you've got to understand that when we would go to a restaurant, he would tell me that the thing to do is always to pick the cheapest wine on the menu, because no good restaurant would ever serve a bad wine. I took that to heart, and then he became a wine connoisseur. Here we are in the Bordeaux Valleys, teaching us about the vineyards. Once he takes something on, it comes on with a passion, and a regular wine bottle just wouldn't be enough for him. And if God gave you 2 hands, why wouldn't you drink with 2 wine glasses? And then he would demonstrate that, in fact, he would really be quite sober after an adventure like this. But if you look just a little bit closer, you notice that right hand is holding onto a chair. Reminds me of a lot of the endovascular tricks and trades. The many faces of Nick, here is in the Colorado River. Great sense of humor. Great grandfather. Here in Chile, and swimming in that lake with the glacier on one end. And here we are in Jackson Hole, and I just want to magnify that a little bit to show you the difference. It's no wonder he wants to wake up like I demonstrated beforehand. But in fact, Nick is a dreamer. He single-handedly has brought together these specialties that you see on the right, which I'm sure he'll be discussing, an incredible accomplishment. He dreamed up this Global Vascular Institute and, in fact, made it a reality. And I'm sure he's going to present this, a dream come true. He finally got his corner office, and he got a meeting room. Here he is with some of his fellows and residents. And if you look a little closer, it's just one of those many, many, many recurring aneurysms after they've been coiled. And I'm sure they said, I wasn't there, but I'm sure he said, yep, we should have clipped it, but then he added right on, hope Spetzler doesn't see this. he left a legacy of trained fellows and residents who just adore him. It is my incredible pleasure to introduce our honored guest, Nick Hopkins, a true neurosurgical visionary.
How do you follow that? Disclosures, they don't have anything to do with this talk. And this is indeed the greatest honor I've ever had. Elad, Ash, Alan, Ali, thank you so much. You know, if you stay in this game long enough, you get a lot of titles after your name. But the reality is, none of that happens without a team. And I owe all the credit to my team, and these guys are just incredible. Ken, Elad, Adnan. And then, just to repeat something that Robert showed, you don't do this without great colleagues, and here we are in the hot tub in Jackson Hole, and some of you will recognize some of the people there. And you don't do it without a great family behind you. And fact is, the most important person in the whole thing is Bonnie. And she's been there with me all the way, and I can't. There's not much I can say except that she's everything. So this whole thing about family and stuff reminds me of this really neat quote that I found from the Dalai Lama. When asked what surprised him most about humanity, he answered, "Man, because he sacrifices his health in order to make money." Then he sacrifices money to recuperate his health. Then he's so anxious about the future that he does not enjoy the present. And the result being that he does not live in the present or the future. He lives as if he is never going to die, and then he dies having never really lived. And so for all of you out there who are competitive and aggressive and driven, keep this in mind as you go through life. There's a lot more important A lot of important stuff beyond just your work. So let me talk a little bit about two things today. One is endovascular neurosurgery, and that really is the minimally invasive approach to the vascular system. It's a new specialty. It's only been around since the early 70s, and back then it was pretty primitive. I think it's our greatest opportunity in neurosurgery, My plea to all of you is get involved. This is the future. And the other thing I want to talk a little bit about is innovation, the future of medicine, and of course neurosurgery. And this is the plate on the window at the Jacobs Institute, which I'll show you. It's all about innovation. Come innovate. Everybody needs to be thinking about innovation, because that's the future. Just a little bit of history. This all started with angiography in 1920 with Moniz, and then the first real embolization of the brain was Lusenhop in 1960. And let me tell you, it was pretty crude. These are the things we used. We used beads, muscle, sponge, silk, all kinds of things that we could crunch up, get small enough to put in a catheter and shoot it up into people's brains. And back then, and for a long time after, the pioneers were very brave, and the patients were blissfully ignorant about what we were doing. You can't talk about history without mentioning this guy, Chuck Kerber. Really is a chronology of our whole specialty. Chuck was a naval aviator, went down in a fireball and burned 70% of his body. The only thing that was left were his fingertips, and became one of the greatest innovators after 2 years in a naval hospital. Chuck basically invented cyanoacrylate, and then he did the first embolization back in 1974. Couldn't see it back then because it was not radiolucent, but he figured out how to do it. And then in 79, he figured out how to opacify this stuff so we could actually see what we were doing. And then a little later on, he invented the calibrated leak balloon and other balloons and the catheters that went with them. He invented all that. And the calibrated leak balloon is still something that we can use effectively today. Then back in 78, Chuck actually was the first guy to figure out how to treat a carotid cavernous fistula by training a balloon to find its way into the fistula, inflating it, and shutting the lesion off and saving people's lives. Guess what? In 1980, he was the first person ever to do a carotid angioplasty. Imagine that. So there have been a lot of recent developments in this field, which we could talk about forever. But I just want to mention a couple of things. One is back in somewhere 25, 28 years ago, Grant Hiroshima came up with the idea of an M&M conference. I mean a real M&M conference where we brought everybody together. The only rule is get up in front of the whole group, present your worst disaster of the year, and then talk about it. That has really changed the specialty, I think. And then another thing that's changed the specialty is learning from the airline industry. If we look at error management, lessons from aviation, what we find is that 70% of all the accidents are directly related to human error, and as evidence, the one that just happened in San Francisco recently. And so we have the same situation in endovascular neurosurgery, and we are beginning to learn from the airline industry, checklists and crew resource management, other things that will take our specialty to another level. Endovascular neurosurgery is really about two important things. One is understanding and managing flow. Pretty simple, but incredibly complicated. The other is understanding and managing coagulation cascade and platelets. So if we really ever get to the point where we totally understand these two things, we'll have it licked. In hemodynamics, it's all about flow. And there are two basic types of flow. One is turbulent flow, vortex formation and so on. The other is laminar flow, where everything lines up, as you see here. And then there's the interesting, fascinating interaction between turbulent flow and laminar flow, in this case, a water spout on the Niagara River. And then that's exactly what you see when you look at certain vascular anomalies, like this aneurysm, where the turbulent flow in that aneurysm is directly affecting the laminar flow in the parent artery. It's the same thing. And then we move to how we could manage flow, concentrating only on flow. And this is the latest, and that is the pipeline stent. And I would say that's the first pure play in managing flow without a lot of other stuff. And if we look back at this in 10 years, we'll call it a Model T. It's very crude, and we have a long way to go. Now, I remember 25 or so years ago, a movie by the name of Fantastic Voyage. How many people remember seeing or hearing about that movie? But I thought it was total nonsense and pie in the sky until I met this dude, Elaine Kaliaros. He's an experimental condensed matter physicist. I don't even know what that means. But he's president of SUNY Albany, the Center for Nanoscience and Engineering. And Kaliaros has built a $14 billion industry collaborative venture to make the most advanced wafer technology center in the world. These guys can do anything with and nanotechnology. And he's agreed to partner with us in what I think is one of the most exciting things that I've ever seen. To help us to develop smart endovascular technology. Why shouldn't we be able to take their technology and put it on catheters and wires and other devices that we implant in the human body? For example, GPS to self-guide catheters. advanced imaging catheters that allow us to actually see what we're doing inside of arteries. And then nanosensors and MEMS, or microelectrical mechanical machines, that actually do work inside of an aneurysm to repair it in ways that we can only guess at now. And making minor modifications in flow that can make all the difference in terms of aneurysm treatment. So a tiny little bumper placed in the right location could change the flow that would allow almost any aneurysm to gradually melt away. Well, the complexity of this whole business reminds me of this wonderful painting, The Carnival of the Harlequins. How many people know the artist? Well, of course, it's Jean Miró. And then that leads me to the next incredibly cool painting, which is Convergence. Anybody know this one? Sure, Jackson Pollock. Anybody know what gallery these two paintings come from? Of course, the Albright Knox in Buffalo. So Convergence is what this whole thing is about. If we can get all of us coming together, all the different disciplines, all the scientists and all the different disciplines coming together to converge on this problem, we will get there. And that leads me to a brief discussion of what we're working on now. And this is, I say the Vascular Center of the Future with a lot of question marks, because this is an experiment. We do not know whether this is actually going to work. But we're excited about it. And these are some pictures of the entrance and the building. Now, this is a map of the stroke belt in the United States. So we're asking, why a vascular center? Well, you see that little yellow circle that just came in. And then if you look on the East Coast, the Far East Coast, what you see is the stroke belt in the United States, where the stroke rate is the highest in the world, for all intents and purposes. Then there's this little black dot in the western corner of New York State. That's Buffalo, New York. So why is the stroke rate so high in western New York? And when people ask me that, my answer is chicken wings. And do you know that Buffalo is the only place in the world that has an annual chicken wing eating contest? As a matter of fact, the Anchor Bar, where this whole thing of chicken wings actually originated, about a month ago, brought in over 40,000 pounds for its chicken wing eating contest. And isn't it ironic that the new Vascular Center is built right in the background behind the Anchor Bar? We're actually considering a zip line. All right, so why a vascular center? Well, it's the number one crippler and killer around the world, isn't it? Heart attack and stroke. And yet, all of us that take care of vascular disease, cardiologists, neurosurgeons, vascular surgeons, radiologists, all of us work in silos in our own departments. We rarely see each other during the day. Sometimes we run into each other at meetings. And then if you go out to the university, you find all the vascular scientists are doing the same thing. They're working in their silos, and they don't talk to each other either. They're all busy working on their next research grant. They don't talk to each other, and they sure don't come down and talk to us clinicians. So one of the things that I've actually asked is I've asked our dean to mandate that every scientist that gets a lab in our new building has to spend 2 hours a week in a cath lab. He looked at me like I was crazy. So bringing all these people together, all of us that work on the vascular system, our goal is to break down the silos. And the other goal is to begin to try to change the treatment paradigm for vascular disease in this country. And isn't that going to be the future of vascular care delivery? Well, all of this was just a dream until a wonderful family, the Jacobs family, came along in Buffalo. And they were looking for something to do to make Buffalo a better place. And they fortunately came to us. And so they've been our partner. They've been the force that's helped us to actually make this happen. Our mantra, collisions leading to collaboration, leading to innovation. And in the beginning, they were responsible for the design of the building, and they were a partnership manager. We had to bring a whole bunch of disparate groups together to make this happen. Well, every time somebody said no to me, I just called up Mr. Jacobs, and he called them up, and things happened. So this is what the Jacobs people allowed us to do, is to bring together a group of the most renowned clinicians in cardiology, vascular surgery, vascular medicine, radiology, and neuro. We all came together at a conference in Jackson, Wyoming, and we were lucky enough to have Mr. Jacobs fly out an architect up in the upper left there, Mehrdad Yastani from L.A., one of the most creative medical architects in the world. And what he said to us was, you guys dream about what medicine is going to be practiced like in 25 years, and let me think about the building. And these are the actual sketches that he made. And if you look on the upper left, you see what looks like a sandwich, and then right next to it is almost exactly what we got in terms of a building. And halfway there through the first morning, if we were talking about connectivity and collaboration and flexibility, he said to us, you guys are telling me you want collisions. You want to bump into each other. And we actually all agreed in unison that that's what we wanted. We also wanted to think of patients as partners, partners in wellness and research. And most importantly, in this day when everybody's pushing industry away from us, we wanted to bring industry back as our partner, partner in innovation, partner in research, and in training. So what the vision is overall is a freestanding building connected to the hospital, physician-led and governed, minimally invasive treatment and prevention of vascular disease, disciplines all forced together by the geography of the building, with the Jacobs Institute as an independent partner to help make things happen and to focus on innovation. One of the hardest things we did was to get independence from the university and from the hospital for the Jacobs Institute. That was a big deal. So our focus is collaboration and innovation. And the building, as you saw, it's a sandwich. And the idea is the Jacobs Institute is the meat in the middle of the sandwich, with the research building on the top and the clinic on the bottom. So here it is. In order to make it happen the way we envisioned it, we had to have a one-acre floor plate. It turned out to be a $300 million venture. And here's the way it stacks up. The research center is on the top. And thanks to our partners from Toshiba, we have a full imaging suite of two angio suites, I mean brand new angio suites, CT, MRI, ultrasound, and CT PET. All of that in the research building with a full animal facility. In the middle, sandwiched in between, is the Jacobs Institute and our conference center. And on the bottom is our vascular center, with cath labs on the fourth floor, vascular ORs on the third floor, our hotel for outpatients on the second floor, and the emergency room below. This design of the fourth floor, with access around the perimeter, and then cath labs on the second layer, and control rooms that are all interconnected, and then a core area with little conference facilities everywhere, is the heart and soul of the building, with all of the vascular disciplines working on one floor and forced to run into each other every day. And the synergies that have arisen from this are staggering. Every day I see our guys out hanging out with cardiologists talking about what they're going to do together. It's an amazing phenomenon. So again, it's about collisions, collaboration, innovation. And in the Jacobs Institute, what we've done is create a center for innovation in medicine. It's kind of a little bit of a different concept within a clinical facility. You see the architect put these kind of cool, different colored lights in our center for innovation. He told us that was going to make us more creative. There's just a couple of shots of the innovation center in the Jacobs Institute at night. So what's the concept? The concept is ideas. It's harvesting ideas from people in the building, scientists, clinicians, entrepreneurs, industry, world-class experts. All kinds of ideas can come into the center. And then we have to figure out how to vet these ideas. And what we have set up in the Jacobs Institute is a way to do that with expertise in intellectual property, make sure it's got freedom to operate, market research, clinical regulatory research. Is there a pathway through the ever-increasingly complex and arcane FDA? If you get past those barriers, we will have a full fab shop for prototyping of almost any medical device you could imagine. We get through the prototyping phase. We have a testing center to put it in a model and test it in a model. If it works there, we can go right upstairs, put it in an animal model, and make sure it works in a live being. If we get through all of that, then we will lateral it to entrepreneurs, friends in the Silicon Valley and the Boston area, who would then take it to the next level in terms of turning it into a viable enterprise. So we'll try to take science and turn it into business. We'll try to take risk out and we'll try to create value through the process in this Center for Innovation. So the future of these sort of disparate groups coming together, again, it's collaboration innovation, redefining partnerships with industry, and delivering the healthcare of the future. So I would invite all of you to come visit, come innovate with us if you have a great idea. Now this whole thing reminds me of, and I'll apologize if anybody's seen this, says you're always going to miss 100% of the shots you don't take. And what I'm encouraging everybody in this room to do is take the shot. Take the shot. If you've got an idea, bring it to somebody. And if we don't screw it up, then I think we have an amazing opportunity. And it all reminds me of this wonderful little note. This is an actual note that was written by an 8-year-old girl named Nicola. She was on a Qantas flight from LAX to Sydney, and it was her first flight, and she wrote this note to the captain. It says, "Dear Captain, my name is Nicola. I'm 8 years old. This is my first flight, but I'm not scared. I like to watch the clouds go by. My mom says the crew is nice. I think your plane is good. Thanks for a nice flight. Don't fuck up the landing. Love, Nicola."